Hello guys, welcome to another video. Today we'll be going over the following physics problem. Pause the video and read the question before I go over my explanation. So, how should we solve this problem? Well, let's first look at the case after a certain length of the rope has fallen down. What it will look like is there will be... This is the sensor, and it's going to read the weight. And there's going to be a length of the rope lying down on the sensor still. And there's going to be the length of the rope that's still falling down onto the sensor. And so these two will provide two different forces onto the sensor, which we can separate and solve for individually. So the force of the falling rope onto the sensor is given by F equals, we can think of this as the change of momentum of the tail end of the rope that's falling down, which gives us the equation F equals dv p dt, which will be, which is the same as Newton's laws. And the second force is from the steel rope that's just lying down. And this is just the force of gravity from the steel rope onto the sensor. Solving for these individually will result in the net force. So let's first solve for the change of momentum from the tail end of the rope, F1. F1 equals dp dt. And instead of thinking this as a change in speed of a constant mass of the rope, we can think of this as a change in mass of the speed of the rope times the speed of the rope, which looks like dm dt times v, which is the speed of the falling end of the rope. So, well, since we don't know dm dt, we can use the chain rule to change them into quantities we do know, which is dm dl. So we sort of put like a dl as an intermediate. And this will be our total force now. And essentially what we did here was we changed it into two quantities that we do know so that we can find dm dt. And the chain rule is very helpful in calculus-based physics problem used like this. And so dm dl is a linear mass distribution of the rope, which is just constant of m over l. And dl/dt is the speed of the rope, dl/dt, which after a certain time t, since it's constantly accelerating downwards at an acceleration of g provided by the gravity, would be gt. And that's provided by the kinematics equations. Same thing for the speed of the rope, v. It's just gt again. And so this provides F1 as m over l times gt squared. The second force is the force from gravity of the rope that's already lying down. And if we call this part of the rope, if we say that it has a length L and a mass M, that means that this force of gravity downwards is going to be little mg, which when expressed as the length L of the rope lying there, would be L times lambda times g. I wrote lambda wrong. Lambda times g. And, well, we know lambda, and we know g. And the length L after a certain time t is, we can use kinematics for that once again, because the rope falls down a length of 1/2 gt squared after a time t due to the constant acceleration equations of kinematics. And once again, we know lambda, we know g. So this results in the total in the equation of m over 2l gt squared. And so our total force right now, once again, would just be these two added up. And once we add them up, we get the equation 3m over 2l times gt squared. So some interesting observations we can make through this equation that we just derived is that we can see that the weight of the rope on the sensor, and this can be left as an exercise for you to do, but if we call only this weight on the sensor, only this part of the rope that's on the sensor, if we call that mass little m, then the force on the sensor is going to show 3mg, or 3 times the weight of the mass of the rope that's on the sensor currently. And following from this, we can also see that the max force of the sensor is going to be 3 big mg when the whole rope falls down onto the sensor, but the sensor still hasn't lowered its sensing to normal mg. And so this will be the max force. And one thing y'all might still be wondering is how we didn't have to, like, normally we know that momentum is equal to mv. And so if we say that the mass is changing, why do we just ignore the second part of the product rule? So let me show you what that looks like. dp dt equals dm dt times v. Then by the product rule, we also have to add dv dt times m. And so this part, it all depends on the system we're looking at. In this problem right here, we're looking at a tiny mass of dm falling down onto v, and we categorize this v in terms of t. If we look at the total system of both the sensor and the rope, the derivation will still result in the same answer, but it'll be a bit different. Essentially, what we'll have to do is we'll have to draw a free body diagram. The whole system is there's going to be an mg downwards, and there's going to be a force of the sensor upwards. And essentially, this new system is going to be F total equals the sensor force minus mg, which once again, m is just lambda lg. And so essentially, what we're trying to calculate is the force of the sensor. So, and we know that F total is dp dt. And dpdt is categorized by this right here. So when we solve, we get that F sense equals, through a bit of algebra, we should get dm dl times dl dt, same thing as before, of course, times v, then plus d squared l dt squared, as d, that's essentially what dv dt is, and times m. Then minus, then plus, I mean, lambda l g, of course. And essentially, we see that we get the same equation as before, as this part right here, same as before we calculated. And if we plug in, we know that this is negative g, and that this is lambda L, we get that these two parts sort of like cancel out. So it results in the same equation as before, and which is this part right here. And yeah, so it all depends on the system we're solving for. This way is a bit more clunky, but it still works out. Okay, and that'll be it for this video. Thanks for watching.